South Pacific for a good number of years. He was director of the Holy Family Pastoral Center in American Samoa and taught missiology and anthropology in the Pacific Regional Seminary in Suva, Fiji Islands. He also taught missiology at the Yarra Theological Union in Box Hill, Australia. He is presently the director, the first director of the Divine Word Institute of Mission Studies in Tagaytay City in the province of Cavite. He teaches missiology in the University of Santo Tomas, in the University of St. Joseph in Macau, in the Institute for Consecrated Life in Asia in Quezon City, and in some schools of theology, at the Recoleto School of Theology in Quezon City, in the Immaculate Conception School of Theology in Bigan, and in his own Divine Word Seminary in Tagaytay City. Let us welcome in our midst Father Edgar Javier, SPD.
Thank you very much, Monsignor. First of all, I would like to thank all of you for giving me this opportunity to be with you today. I am honored to be with my brother priests who are very much involved in catechesis. But before I begin, I'd like to invite you to the National Mission Conference to be held on May 18 to 21 this year in Tagaytay. This is organized by the CPCP ECM, Episcopal Commission on Mission. This is going to help us prepare for the celebration of 500 years of Christianity in 2021. So I would be very happy to see you also in Tagaytay. Bishop Bastes is the one in charge of this. Secondly, I'd like to invite you to come and study missiology at the Divine Word Institute of Mission Studies. I have some brochure with me. If you're interested, I'll be happy to share them with you. And this is our first journal, Missio Inter Gentes. If you're interested, give me your postal address and I will give you a copy. I will send you a copy from Tagaytay, or I'll give it to Monsignor so that you can have an idea of what is going on in the world today. There are two theological disciplines that are very exciting today. First is moral theology because of bioethics. And second is missiology because of multiculturality and religious pluralism. So these two disciplines today are very exciting. Now I go to my paper. It's a 14-page paper. I'm not going to read it to you. It's too academic. So I must be freewheeling about it. And later on, I'll give a copy to Monsignor Jerry, perhaps for publication. First, dialogue is a newcomer in the church documents. It was only introduced in 1964 by Paul VI in his encyclical Ecclesiam Summa. Remember, 1962-65, we had the Second Vatican Council, and while it was taking place, Paul VI wrote this encyclical Ecclesiam Summa and used the word dialogue for the first time. In the original language, the word used is colloquium, but later on in the translation, they used the word dialogue. So the topic given to me is the tripod of dialogue and its implications to Philippine catechetics. So I will begin with a description of Asia, which includes the Philippines. Asia is an amazing continent. It is a continent that continuously amazes people for the simple reason that it is the home of many cultures, many traditions, religious traditions, philosophies, spiritualities, and so on and so forth. There is a lot of variety in this continent. So that if we talk of Asia, we do not mean Asia as a group of nations. Asia is a world of many worlds. And in knowing Asia, there are three very important words to understand. First is difference. Second is diversity. And third is plurality. So when the word Asia comes to mind, please remember these two and these three beautiful words that have emerged more clearly in these postmodern times. Difference, diversity, and plurality. On the other hand, Asia is also a crying continent. On the one hand, it is an amazing continent. It is a continent of charm. It is at the same time a continent of cruelty, a continent of surprising contrasts. So in Asia, we hear the cry of crucified humanity today. Of course, that was going on already in the past. However, because of media and other things, we are more aware now of what is happening. For example, human beings are now turned into human capital in the name of the word commodity. In Asia, young men and women are commodified because of human trafficking. When I was a missionary in the Pacific, the dumping place for human commodities was Fiji. They would travel from the Philippines to Thailand, to Singapore, then to Australia, and finally, they would be sold in Fiji as human commodities for two reasons. First, for medical experiments, and second, for sex industry. These are Asians, and many of them also come from the Philippines. So Asia is a continent of crying humanity because of the commodification of human beings, especially the young ones. At the same time, Asia is also a crying continent because creation is growing in Asia. The seas, the oceans, the mountains, the plains, everything that surrounds us are reduced into natural capital. Not long ago, I was in Myanmar. What did I see? Endless trucks carrying products of Myanmar brought to China. These are lands, natural resources, and so on and so forth. Finally, we hear the cry of cultures and world religions in Asia, asking us for deeper understanding and more respect for cultures and religions in Asia. They are crying also because of the mentality of many Asians that divide, that abhor these voices we hear them today in Asia. At the same time, I'd like to present to you the picture of modern or postmodern Asia. Postmodern Asia is very different. In other words, the traditionally inclined Asians are becoming postmodern Asians. This is because of the mega trends that are taking place in the continent, in the Philippines in particular. The first mega trend is migration. The rate of migration in the Philippines, in Asia, is enormous. That is why we call it mega migration, within Asia and outside of Asia. And this mega trend is creating new borders.